Once again, happy Father's Day. We have a
good crowd. We have visitors that are with us. We're glad that you're with us this morning. A couple of things I want to mention before we get started.
I don't know if you saw on Facebook, but Dwayne Sayer was able to put up a new sign for welcomes our visitors or people into town, a church sign, and it was over at Smiley's, which is prime country. I mean, that people coming from the south, that's where they go, and they didn't have to do that, but they graciously offered, or I guess Francis talked to them about doing that, and they were glad to, and you know, it's something that they might get a little flack. How come you let the Church of Christ put a sign up and wouldn't let us or whatever? I don't know. But we're glad that it's there. And if you know that family, if you know the owners, if you see them, be sure and thank them and let them know how much we appreciate their allowing us to put a church sign up there. A really nice sign. Dwayne did a great job in getting that together and putting that up there too. Thank you, Dwayne. I want to say thank you. We have so many in our congregation that can step up and do so many different things. Wednesday night, I understand Paul Bookout did a fabulous job in filling in for me and teaching a class, and I got to see a little bit of it, a little preview of it, and wow, it's a great lesson. I'm sure it was great, and grateful for Paul and his family, and I don't know anybody that brings more people to services on Sundays than Debbie. She's always asking her co-workers and neighbors and things, and she goes and picks them up or brings them here, is looking for them, and I appreciate that so much about Debbie. So Paul and Debbie appreciate that. And then in a couple of weeks, 3 weeks, I guess, maybe four, July 14th, I've been asked to go preach in Wynnewood, back where I used to preach all during the 90s, and they're going to have Family Day. There were a couple of families that were here from Wynnewood, and so they remember we did that then, and they wanted me to come back and preach on July 14th for their Family Day. And so Justin Bishop is going to fill in for me and preach that Sunday morning, and we're blessed to have the bishops here, and we're ready for them to get moved here. Ready. I'm sure you're ready too. So anyway, are we good to go, John? Anyway, happy Father's Day. And as was mentioned, if you did not get one of the little Father's Day gifts, little flashlight, it's bright too. It's bright. And if you got it and you tried it and it didn't work, then you're like me. I didn't read the directions. How many did that? All right. You got to take an end off and take the tab off of the battery, and then it'll work. So I appreciate Kim. She's so thoughtful in making sure we have things like that for different occasions. And so I appreciate that so very much. Am I hooked? Let's see. I got to turn this on now. There we go. There's a serious need today in our society, in our community, even in our churches, for godly fathers. Children need godly fathers. The church needs godly fathers. Our community needs godly fathers. And God does as well. Now, I want you to know, I understand even in our family here, there are those that do not have fathers. Either they passed on or they're just no longer part of the family. And that's where we as a community, a family, have one another to kind of step up and be a role model for those that don't have fathers. I appreciate so much Doug mentioning that in his prayer because it's so true. And today, there's such a lack of fathers. I found some statistics. Oh, I didn't bring them. But we know what they are. They're just the lack of fathers in the homes. 85% of those that are in jail have no fathers in the picture. We see so many others that we're aware of in the community, and those that have emotional problems and even financial problems, those that have social problems, so many of them did not have a father in the home or a father figure, perhaps in the church. And that's one of the benefits and one of the values and blessings of the church is that we as men can be a father figure to others that might not have that in their lives. But the devastation of fatherless homes is unbelievable. Fathers, we understand, and I appreciate so much all the fathers that are here, the idea of being present. in the home. And I'm not just talking about a physical presence, but I'm talking about an emotional presence and a spiritual presence as well. It's one thing to be in the home and be a presence there, and you've got your head in the Facebook or some other thing, or in the paper. It's another to be a part of their lives. I saw a sign just yesterday. It only takes a moment to have a moment, right? And it only takes a moment with a child to have one of those special moments that are unplanned, but they will be there for a memory. And God calls us to be faithful fathers. God instituted the home, and the fathers are to be the head of the household. We have greater responsibility, I believe, to make sure that we're living the life that we should, and we're directing and leading our children in the way that they should go. Sometimes it means that we sacrifice things that we might want to do or we might deem important to us for the sake of our children. We hang on to relationships and we sacrifice other things because our children are the most important thing. The Bible tells us that God needs these fathers. He needs fathers to be the head of the household. God needs fathers to be leaders in the family, leaders, I believe, in the church, and even leaders, if at all possible, in the community around us. It's important that our children see that we are leaders and that we lead morally, we lead in so many other ways, and of course that we be teachers. We are teachers, aren't we? People say that I have a lot of mannerisms that my dad had when it comes to preaching and other things, and I'm sure they'd say the same thing about you or when I lead singing, whatever it might be. We teach our children. And we need to be the right type of teachers. There's a father playing catch. I thought it was a baseball at first, but a little teddy bear thing, playing catch with his daughter. But we know what that's like, most of us. We teach our children how to do various things, how to catch, how to fish, how to golf, how to play softball, baseball, how to work a computer, how to do a lot of different things. We teach our children those things, and that's what God needs us to do, is to teach. But we need to be as focused on teaching our children about God and about faith as we are, even more so than we are teaching them things like how to hit a baseball, how to throw a football, how to tie a fishing line on a lure, how to do things like that, how to change oil in the car, change a tire. We need fathers to teach their children about God and about faith. In Deuteronomy, children of Israel just now beginning a new covenant relationship with God. Now they had a closer relationship with God, and that they're out of Egypt, and God was leading them. But he's also asking them to do new things or different things. And in particular, he talks to the fathers, and he says in Deuteronomy chapter 4, "Only give heed to yourself and keep your soul diligently, so that you do not forget the things which your eyes have seen, and they do not depart from your heart all the days of your life. But make them known to your sons and your grandsons." Now, girls aren't out of the picture either. It's implied for the women as well, the daughters as well. Fathers, you make sure your sons and your daughters, that your household knows these things. Remember the day that you stood before the Lord your God at Horeb. The whole nation of Israel at the foot of the mount of Horeb. And the Lord said, "Assemble the people to me, that I may let them hear my words, so that they may learn to fear me all the days that they live on the earth, and that they may teach their children." You're here today. You're teaching your children by your example that it is important that you assemble, that you come and you worship, that we sing songs, and that we pray together, and we study God's word, we observe the Lord's Supper, and we give back as we've been prospered. You're teaching them. And we know actions speak louder than words. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, it says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your sons and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Write what? The commands of God. The things that God asks of us to do, requires of us to do, that they see it in our lives. It's still true today that our children should see the value and the importance and the commitment that we have to God. And that's what God needs. That's what we all need. And I'm grateful for fathers that do that. Deuteronomy 11, 18 through 21. You shall therefore impress these words of mine on your heart and on your soul, and you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall teach them to your sons, talking of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk along the road, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates, so that your days and the days of your sons may be multiplied on the land which the Lord swore to your fathers to give them, as long as the heavens remain above the earth. Now, don't miss what he's saying here. You live this life of which I've called you, so that not only will you be blessed, but your sons will be blessed as well in living in the place that God has asked us to live. My dad taught me a lot of things. I remember him coming home and grabbing a bat and a ball, and we couldn't wait, and going out in the front yard and him hitting ground balls to us and hitting ground balls and teaching us how to throw it correctly. And I remember him playing football and taking us fishing. But one thing that he showed us as well as taught us was how to live faithfully in the eyes of God. We all need fathers like that. And hopefully that's what we all do. And I want to tell you something. It's never too late to pick up where we ought to be living and doing what we ought to be doing. And perhaps the impact might be even more powerful when later in life our children see us, you know, say, I need to reorganize, reprioritize. I need to refocus. I need to change and get back where I should be. And having older children, they understand that much more when they see it than when they were younger, perhaps. But we need fathers, and God needs fathers who will teach their children Bible stories and Bible songs and prayers and how to pray and how to deal with life situations God's way as opposed to man's way. We do so by our example. In Psalm 44, he says, O God, we've heard with our ears, our fathers have told us the work that thou didst in their days and the days of old. The fathers have told us. Listen, O my people, Psalm 78, to my instruction. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings of old, which we've heard and known, and our fathers have told us. We will not conceal them from their children, but tell to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wondrous works that he has done. We teach by example. Too many times we say one thing and do something else, and that's teaching as well, but not the right way. Psalm 101, verse 2. It says, I will give heed to the blameless way. When wilt thou come to me? I will walk within my house in the integrity of my heart. Paul would say, brethren, join in my example. Observe those who walk according to the pattern that you have in us. Live the way that I live. We're to be salt and light. I love the little flashlight, a reminder. That's what we are. Shine and light the way. Taking our families with us. You're the salt of the earth. that the salt had become tasteless. How will it be made salty again? It's good for nothing anymore except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You're the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do men light a lamp and put it under the peck measure, but on the lampstand it gives light to all who are in the house. That's what we're supposed to do. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Faithfulness, obedience, sacrifice, commitment, prayer, Bible study, honesty, responsibility, courtesy, kindness, respect, integrity, all these things. In Exodus chapter 20, verse 12, we're told to honor our parents. It's one of the Ten Commandments. Paul would repeat in Ephesians chapter 6, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment, with the promise that it may be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. We're to listen to them as well. Come September, my dad will have been gone 8 years. Died at the age of 75. That just doesn't seem very old, does it? But I want to tell you, I still listen to him. I still listen to him. And your kids listen to you. Whether you're around or not, they will listen to you. So we have this call to teach. I'd rather hear a sermon or see a sermon than hear one any day. I would rather one walk with me than merely tell the way. The eye is a better pupil and more willing than the ear. Fine counsel is often confusing, but example is always clear. My dad used to say that a lot. I still hear it today. God needs from fathers that we teach children about Him, about faith, about the walk as a child of God. Something else children need that from fathers and God needs is that of discipline. We can talk about lots of different discipline. One is, of course, the, you know, spare the rod, spoil the child, and we'll talk about that. But also just discipline that it takes to be a faithful and committed child of God. Discipline. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4, it says, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and the admonition or instruction of the Lord. And this is love in action. That sometimes we have to discipline our children. I don't want to tell you, if we don't, there'll come a time when someone else will, maybe with the light flashing on top of the car and a badge right here. That's part of the problem today, is that we have children that don't understand discipline. It's been a big debate, but I really believe if we talk to sociologists and psychiatrists and we talk to social workers, you know, children have changed. Have you heard that, how children have changed? I really don't think children have changed. I think we as parents and adults have changed in regards to things like discipline. Look what it says in Hebrews chapter 12. My son, do not regard lightly the discipline of the Lord, nor faint when you are reproved by him. For those whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. And he scourges every son whom he receives. It's for discipline that you endure. God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom his father does not discipline? Well, we could probably say a lot of them today, huh? I'm not talking about abuse. We're talking about discipline, whether it's withholding something, punishing them, whatever it might be. When our children know, when I say no, I mean no. We need fathers like that because it prepares our children for life, to respect authority, to submit to authority, to understand that there are things that we have to do whether we want to or not. This idea of being prepared for life. Proverbs 26, or 22, verse 6, train up a child in the way he should go when he's old and not depart from it. Now, that's a proverb, but for the most part, I think it's true. Not always. Proverbs 19 says, discipline while there is hope, that they might learn discipline. They might understand certain things. Proverbs 22:15 tells us it removes foolishness and folly. It's not always easy. When you get older, you understand sometimes when your parents said, this hurts me more than you. And it does, but it still must be done. Still must be done. Not for our benefit, but for theirs. Proverbs 22:15, we read as well. There's so many others that teach us about the value of discipline. A fool refuses discipline, and a fool refuses, I think, to give discipline as well. I got fired one time. Only one time. You're fired. It was my dad that did it. In a minute, I'm going to show you a picture about a father who provides, and I was trying to think of one. I thought, I've got the perfect one, picture of my dad, and I'm sorry if you're offended by that. But we were working, and I was in high school, maybe college, I guess, and I just knew I needed to go to this thing, this event. It was even a spiritual religious thing, VBS on Wednesday night or Tuesday night in another town, but there was a girl. And I kept saying, Dad, I need to drive to Stratford, 65 miles away, and go to VBS. No, son, you're not going tonight. But, Dad, you don't understand. No, you're not going tonight. But, Dad, I mean, it's a spiritual thing. You don't want me to do a spiritual thing? You know how we find ways to... Well, we were drilling a well. And I was the man running the pipe, the drill collars, the stems and things, and he's running the machinery, big old, and I just would not let go. Son, you don't always get to do what you want to do. I will never forget that. Yeah, but Dad, and he said, you are fired. Go sit in the pickup. So I sat there for a while and watched him do everything. It was a two-man job, and he was doing it all. And it wasn't easy, but he was showing me love in action. And I still remember that to this day. I went and apologized and worked it out and things. So I got rehired. A fool refuses to discipline, or a fool refuses correction. Proverbs 13:18, poverty and shame will come to him who neglects discipline, but he who regards reproof will be honored. A fool rejects his father's discipline, but he who regards reproof is prudent. Jeremiah, listen, they were having problems with the people. And in chapter 7, verse 23, he says, obey my voice. This is what I commanded them, saying, obey my voice, and I'll be your God. You'll be my people. And you will walk in all the way which I commanded you, that it may be well with you. Yet they did not obey or incline their ear, but walked in their own counsels and in their stubbornness of their evil heart, and went backward, not forward. Since the day that your fathers came out of the land of Egypt until this day, I've sent you all my servants, the prophets, daily rising early and sending them, yet they did not listen to me or incline their ear, but stiffened their neck. They did evil more than their fathers, and you shall speak all these words to them, but they will not listen to you, and you shall call to them, but they will not answer you. If they won't listen and answer, and we don't make them as parents and as fathers, they'll not listen and answer to God. There's my dad. We're called to provide. My dad was Bible chair director in Ada for 10 years. Taught Bible, taught college courses, marriage and family and gospels and other things at East Central, but it just was difficult financially. And he had opportunity to go and take over my dad's, his dad's business, my granddad. And so he did it. I'm not sure he really didn't love preaching more, but he understood he had an obligation to provide, to bless. So that's who I thought of, what I thought of. Wearing his drilling rig cap on the drilling rig. We are obligated to provide. And I'm not just talking about financially. We're obligated, I believe, it's important that we provide what's needed. And sometimes that is saying no. And it takes wisdom to understand the difference between what is wanted and what is needed. Matthew chapter 6. Told that a father is to provide. Do not be like them, for your father knows what you need before you ask. Talking about a heavenly father, but we usually as fathers, we know what they need before they ask. And then in verses 32 and 33, it says that the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things, for your heavenly father knows that you need all these things. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. We have that obligation to give them what they need before what they want. Luke 11 says, suppose one of your fathers is asked by his son for a fish. You'll not give him a snake, will he? If he's asked for an egg, he'll not give him a scorpion. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? There's the key, that we know what good gifts to give to our children. And we provide for them the things that they need. Paul would say, if anyone does not provide for his own, 1 Timothy 5, verse 8, if you don't provide for your own, especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. Now, that doesn't mean give them everything that they want. Some of the worst things that can happen is we give our children everything they want instead of understanding and teaching them what they need. And more than anything, spiritual leadership is what we should provide. Genesis 18, verse 19. It says, I've chosen him in order that he may command his children and his household after him to keep the way of the Lord by doing righteousness and justice, in order that the Lord may bring upon Abraham what he has spoken about him. I've chosen Abraham. And I love Joshua 24. We know that one, don't you? If it's disagreeable in your sight to serve the Lord, choose for yourselves this day whom you'll serve, whether the gods which your fathers served, which are beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorite, in whose land you're living. But as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. It's a decision that we make, that fathers need to provide. Grateful for Father's Day. Opportunity to let our fathers know how important they are. And to thank them. And we thank you. And I thank you. And we should pray for more godly fathers. And pray for us that we be better godly fathers. And so we say Happy Father's Day. One of my all-time favorite baseball players, Cal Ripken Jr. He broke the record for the most consecutive starts in a baseball game, over 2,000 starts. At his Hall of Fame induction, he was thanking different people, and he said that first and foremost, or not first and foremost, but one of the most important people that he wanted to thank was his father. He said, he taught me how to be consistent and committed and how to be a person of integrity and a person who's responsible, and you get up and you do what you're supposed to do, whether you feel like it or not. He said, my father taught me those things. He said, my goal is to be like my father. to understand that our goal, I hope, is that our children will be like us, and that we are who we need to be and what we need to be and where we need to be spiritually. Happy Father's Day. Maybe the example of your father has reminded you of the importance of being committed and being a child of God, becoming a child of a heavenly Father. And you can do that this morning. You can become a child of God and claim Him as your Father by putting Christ on in baptism. Maybe you're not where you ought to be, and you want to show by example that you're ready to make a change and to recommit and repent and rededicate and start living right. Maybe you have some other need that we can pray with you and for you. Whatever your need might be, if you would, come now as we stand and as we sing.